Hello everybody and welcome to this Copernicus Marine Service training. I'm Etienne Sayouk from Noveltis and today I'm going to show you an exercise on the marine heatwave episode in the Red Sea. Most people are familiar with atmospheric heatwaves, but you all know that oceans and seas also experience a similar phenomenon called marine heatwave. They are defined as a period of at least 5 days of unusually high sea surface temperature above the 19th percentile threshold of SST climatology. The mechanisms and consequences behind these events are not fully understood yet, and their study is relatively recent. Severe marine heat waves have been affecting the Red Sea in the last decades, according to Mohamed et al., that we can see on this graph. Indeed, it is an almost enclosed sea located in between the African and Asian continents here. It has an elongated shape with a length of approximately 2000 km and an average width of 220 km. It is also home of the world's second longest coral reef system. These fragile marine ecosystems are particularly sensitive to high water temperature. A prolonged marine heatwave event therefore results in part of some coral reef dying and therefore bleaching, according to Genevieve et al. 2019. This could in turn have dramatic consequences on the tourism economy and aquaculture. Detecting and monitoring marine heatwave in the Red Sea, for example at the beginning of June 2019, here, is hence of prime importance for decision makers and stakeholders. The SST data in the Siemens products with their global coverage, high spatial and temporal resolution are particularly efficient to assess the intensity, spatial and temporal extent of the marine heatwave affecting the Red Sea. In this training, we will see how to visualize a marine heatwave episode in the Red Sea in June 2019, according to Mohamed et al., using Copernicus Marine Service products, and we will assess its impact on coral reef. All this exercise will be done in QGIS, which is a free GIS software that allows to manipulate multiple meteocean and geographic data. Siemens data have a common NetCDF file format, which enables to handle several complex variables. In order to facilitate the manipulation of NetCDF file, Noveltis have developed a plugin in QGIS, which can be easily installed following the steps described in the user manual of this training, and all additional material used in this training is also provided with the user manual. First of all, we are going to set a new QGIS project and add a background layer. So to do so, we can just click on layer, add a layer, and go to add WMS layer here. Now you have to just connect to the map server demo. You can find the URL of this server on the user manual, and you can just click on connect. Now we are going to select the blue marble layer to add the background to our map. You can just select the blue marble layer and click on add, and then close this window. Here you have the background of your map. And now we are going to start to map the Copernicus Marine Service products of sea surface temperature. So these products can be added to your project using the NetCDF to GIS plugin. You just have to click on this Siemens logo here to open the plugin. First of all, we are going to display the variable of sea surface temperature, and we are focusing on the sea surface foundation temperature, which is a variable at 10 meter depths, which is free of diurnal variability. Click on the plus icon to find your data and browse in your directories. And we are going to load the first week of June 2019. Click on open. And here you have access to your project. The Copernicus Marine Service Global Ocean Surface Temperature Observation Product. You have access to the variables, dimensions, and unit of this product, and the name of the variable, the sea surface foundation temperature. You have also access to metadata describing the product. And here you can find the spatial resolution, which is 120 degrees or 0.05 degrees, and this product has a temporal resolution of a day because we have downloaded daily mean data. Here we are going to display a quick animation of this netcdf file and this sea surface foundation temperature. To do so, you can just click on the analyzed SST variable here, and you are going to right click on it to display option of the plugin. And here you have two options: add layers to only add some layers to your background project, or sequence layers. Here we are going to select sequence layers. And here you can choose all the time frames you want to display on your QGIS project. So click on the first time frame, press shift, sorry, on your keyboard, select the last time frame, and then you can click on start. we are going to keep the palette as spectral, and we are going to set the minimum and maximum values of the representation on all the layers. Click on start. Now you can see that on the background, if you zoom on the Red Sea, we have all the time frames of the SST variable scrolling in your QGIS project. We can see that we have a maximum of sea surface temperature on this central part of the Red Sea. You can go back to your dialog box and just stop the animation and close this window. Now we are going to focus on only one layer to access the minimum and maximum values of SST during the first week of June 2019. For example, you can select the 3rd of June, right click on it, and open properties. Here you have access to the minimum and maximum values of this of all these layers of June 2019. So with 294 Kelvin for the minimum value and 306 Kelvin for the maximum value. In the following, we are going to show you how to compute a conversion of these layers from Kelvin degrees to Celsius degrees. It can be sometimes more convenient to work with Celsius degrees. To apply this conversion, we need to perform a batch process. So we are going to apply the same raster calculator expression to all the layer at the same time. To do so, we are going to open the processing toolbox, click on processing, then toolbox here, and we are going to look for raster calculator. And here you can just right click, remind to select the raster calculator from JDAL and not the one from raster analysis. So right click on the raster calculator and select execute as batch process. So here you can select the input layer A, which is the variable we will apply the conversion on. So for the first layer, just select the 1st of June. And we are going to add as much rows as many rows as we have layers here. So you can apply 7 layers. Here we are going to just change the second row to the 2nd of June and so on. Now we are going to set the computation expression, the calculation in GDAL numeric syntax. So we want to select our variable A, which is the layer in Kelvin, and we want to apply a conversion to Celsius degrees. So we are going to subtract 273.15 Kelvin. So we are going to copy and paste this expression. So Control plus C on your keyboard, and just apply it to the other rows. And now we are just going to set the output file. So if you go to the column calculated here, you can just click on the three points to add the name of the output layer. So here we are going to call it analyze SST with the date, and we will add underscore DXC for Celsius degrees at the end of the name. You can click on save. Here I have already computed this layer, so I need to overwrite this layer. So just click on yes. Here you can select to not autofill the layer. Click on OK. And then you can just select all the path and the output name here. Press Ctrl and C on your keyboard to copy this expression and paste it to all the following rows. And then just change the date of the day on your keyboard corresponding to each layer from the 1st to the 7th of June 2019. When it is done, so we are starting from analyze SST in Kelvin here for each day from the 1st to the 7th of June, and we are applying a subtraction of 273.15 Kelvin to get the analyze SST in Celsius degrees. You can just remind to check the load layers on completion to display these new layers on our QGIS project, and then you can just click on run. When it is done, you can select close here to close this window, and we are just going to put our analyzed SST in Celsius degrees layers on top of the other layers. So you can just select layers without Celsius degrees extension and drag them below the DXC extensions. Okay. Now we are going to adapt the palette and the color range of this new layers in Celsius degrees. Here you can just close the processing toolbox. For example, if you go to the 7th of June 2019 in Celsius degrees, you can just open the properties tab, right click on the layer and open properties. Here we are going to change the render type to single band pseudo color. We are going to set the minimum value to 25 degrees and the maximum value to 33 degrees. And we are going to change the color ramp and invert it to have minimum values of SST in blue and maximum values in red. You can click on apply and OK. Now you can see the resulting layer has got blue-red colors from 25 degrees to 33 degrees. We are going to apply this style to other layers with the extension Celsius degrees. And to do so, right click on the first layer, go to style, copy style, and select all the layers with the DXC extension. Press shift on your keyboard, select the last layer, right click on it, and then you can apply the same style. So click on paste style. Now we can see that if we scroll between our layers, we have the same style from 25 degrees to 33 degrees. And we can see that there is a maximum of SST at the center of the Red Sea. But we want to know how high is this maximum of SST compared to the SST usually experienced in the Red Sea at this time of the year. So you have to remember that the Marine Heat Wave event is characterized relatively to the SST mean value at the same time of the year, called climatology. In order to characterize our potential Marine Heat Wave event, we are hence going to compute a mean SST value over the Red Sea for the first week of June, but for the decade from 2009 to 2019, and this way we will be able to assess and compare how unusually warm the SST in the Red Sea is compared to the previous decade. So up to this point, we have worked with the daily SST fields, and in order to simplify the exercise, we will compute weekly SST means. This way, we will end up with a single average SST anomaly for the first week of June 2019. So now we are going to import the values of daily SST from the 1st to the 7th of June for all the years from 2009 to 2019. To do so, you can only with the plugin and the plus option add one netcdf file at a time. So now we are just going to open the directory containing all the SST files from 2009 to 2018. And just you are going with shift on your keyboard, and you can just drag all these files and drop them onto the netcdf tab of your netcdf to gis plugin. Here you can just enlarge the name column, and you have access to the name of each netcdf file. So we are going to add each year the first week of June and the Sea Surface Foundation temperature corresponding. So select the netcdf file, select the analyzed SST variable, right click on it, and here you can select add layers. We are going to select layers from the 1st to the 7th of June for the year 2009. Select all the layers with shift pressed on your keyboard, and here just remind to rename the group with the year. So we are going to add 2009 to the group name, and just let minimax of all layers and the spectral palette. Then you can click on add and close. You can see that the new group analyzed SST for the year 2009 has been added to your QGIS project. And now we are going to do the same for all the years from 2009 to 2018. So here I'm missing the layer for 2014, so I'm going to add it individually. Okay. Sorry, this is not the good file. So here I'm going to select the 2014 year. Just select Analyze SST. Click on Add Layers, and you can add the 7 days. Remind to rename it. And we follow the importation. It's a long step, but we need all these layers to then compute the mean, the weekly mean, over the last decade. Here for 2017, and then the last one, 2018. Okay, now you can just reduce the netcdf to gis plugin, and in your layer tab here you should have all these layers, a group of analyzed SST and the year, and then the 7 days, 7 first days of June of the corresponding year, from 2009 to 2018, and we at the beginning we have loaded 2019. Now we are working with a daily SST with Kelvin units. The step of converting to Celsius degrees was only to show you how to convert to a convenient unit. And we are going to assess the SST weekly mean between 2009 and 2019 in order to compute later the SST anomaly between the first week of June 2019 and the weekly mean during the last decade. So now we are computing the weekly mean of the last decade. To do so, we are going to open the raster calculator here. And now we have to sum all the layers and divide them by the number of layers we have. To do so, we have already completed the expression on the user manual, and I advise you to copy it from the user manual and paste it on the raster calculator expression here. So this is a big expression, as you can see, and a long one, which is summing all the layers, all the SST daily from 1st to 7th of June from 2009 to 2019, and we are dividing this sum by the number of days to compute the weekly mean. Here you can just select the output name of this layer. To do so, you have to click here on output layer. And you can save it on your working directory. So here, and you can call it weekly underscore mean underscore June between 2009 and 2019. Click on save. Just do not change the GeoDiff output format, and then you can click on OK. And here you have the resulting weekly mean layer, so you can just take it out of the Analyze SST group to put it on top of all your layers, and then you can reduce all the groups of SST. We are going to keep, sorry, the Analyze SST fields of June 2019. On this new resulting layer, we are going to change the color scale. So right-click on it and open Properties. Here again, we are going to change the render type to single band pseudocolor. And here we are in Kelvin. So on the step before, we made a palette from 25 degrees Celsius degrees to 33 Celsius degrees, and now we are going to set the same values in Kelvin corresponding to the same interval. So if we set to 298.15 for the minimum value to 306.15, we have SST interval corresponding to 25 Celsius degrees to 33 Celsius degrees. We are going to invert the color ramp to have values from blue to red, and then we can click on apply. So here we have the representation of the weekly mean SST from 2009 to 2019 on the last decade. What can be interesting now is to compare this weekly mean for the first week of June of the last decade to the layer of June on 2019. So to do so, we are just going to uncheck all the SST layers here and just compare these two layers. Here it's the SST in June 2019, and we can change the day, for example. So we can see that we have maximums of sea surface temperature in the center of the Red Sea. And in comparison with the same value interval and the same value range of SST, we can see that the weekly mean is less red. So we notice a much higher SST in the Red Sea over the first week of June 2019 in comparison to the weekly climatology for the first week of June between 2009 and 2019. So now let's compute and display the SST weekly anomaly layer, which is computed as the difference between the mean SST of the first week of June 2019 in Kelvin and the SST climatology for the first week of June during the decade from 2009 and 2019. To do so, you need again to open the raster calculator here and to type the expression which is provided in the user manual. I'm just pasting from the user manual. So on the first term of this subtraction, we have the SST weekly mean over the first week of June 2019 in Kelvin, so corresponding to these layers. And on the second member of this subtraction, we have the climatology of the first week of June on the last decade, so this layer. Then you can select the output name here and just select weekly underscore anomaly on June 2019. Click on save and just click on OK. And here you have the resulting layer, which is in levels of gray. So we are going to change the properties to tune the representation of this new layer of anomaly. Right click on this layer, open properties. We are going to change the render type to single bound pseudocolor again. We are going to set the minimum value from 1 Kelvin to 3 Kelvin and invert the color ramp to have colors from blue to red. Click on apply and OK. Now you have tuned the representation of the SST weekly anomaly between the first week of June 2019 and the weekly mean of the first week of June in 2019. So applying successive steps on the CMEMS product of global ocean surface temperature observations lead us to computing this anomaly layer, and we can see that the resulting values highlight a strong SST anomaly reaching 3 degrees in the center of the RATI here during the first week of June 2019. Now you can export this layer as a GeoJSON, but as GeoJSON export is only possible from vector layers, we need to apply a conversion of this layer to a vectorized layer. To do so, select your anomaly layer, click on raster here, then conversion, and select polygonize. Here you have just to select so your input layer, which is the weekly anomaly layer, okay, and we can just click on run. You can then close this layer, and here you have a vectorized layer appearing, and then you can just right click on it, select export, save feature as, change the output format to GeoJSON, and change the output file name to weekly anomaly June 2019.geojson. Again, my GeoJSON is already existing, so I'm going just to change the output directory and save it. Now you can click on OK, and you have the GeoJSON corresponding to the weekly anomaly June 2019 layer. Now, in order to identify, you can just uncheck these two layers. We are going to keep working with the weekly anomaly raster here with the good color scale. Now we have computed the anomaly for the first week of June 2019, and we want to identify areas where we have a marine heat wave. So in order to identify those areas, We will use a simplified criterion from the 19th percentile of the SST climatology presented in Mohamed et al. Paper. And for the purpose of this exercise, we will consider that a marine heatwave event is occurring if the weekly anomaly displayed here is higher than 1.5 Kelvin. So, first of all, we are going to create a mask identifying areas where the weekly anomaly June 2019 layer values are higher than 1.5 Kelvin. To do so, we are going to select the weekly anomaly layer and open the raster calculator. Click on raster, raster calculator. So you have to select the same layer here, and we are going to select the expression. We want the weekly anomaly layer of June 2019, which is higher than 1.5 Kelvin. So here we can just rename the output layer to marine heatwave, because this resulting layer is going to be the layer where marine heatwave episode is occurring. Then you can click on OK. So just take this marine heatwave resulting layer on top, and we can see that we have white and black values, so we are two domains. We have now a layer depending on the following condition. The SST anomaly for the first week of June 2019 is higher than 1.5 Kelvin, and this layer, marine heat wave, is filled with 0, where the condition is false, and 1, where the condition is true, where at 1, so the white values are corresponding to the areas where the weekly anomaly in June are higher than 1.5 Kelvin. So now we are going to convert this new raster layer marine heat wave into polygons, because the final goal of this exercise is to compute the intersection between marine heat wave areas in polygons with coral reef areas, which are polygons also, using a polygon tools in QGIS. To convert this raster layer to polygons, we are going to use a tool from the processing toolbox. Just go to processing and open the toolbox. And here we are going to type vector creation. So we are going in this group, and here we are going to select raster pixels to polygon. This one, it's going to convert each pixel of our raster layer here in a polygon with a value 0 if the anomaly is lower than 1.5 Kelvin, or 1 if the anomaly is higher than 1.5 Kelvin. Open the raster pixel to polygon function. Here we are going to rename the resulting field by marine heat wave, and then you can click on run and close this window and close the processing toolbox. You can see that you have, if you zoom, one polygon for each pixel of this raster layer. If we deactivate the last time, each pixel in this layer is replaced by one polygon. So now we will filter this vector layer by a value on each polygon, because each polygon has a value of 0 or 1, and we want to only keep polygons with value equal to 1, polygons where the anomaly is higher than our 1.5 Kelvin threshold. So right-click on the vector polygon layer here and open filter. Now you can type the expression we are going to filter on the marinate wave variable, and we just want to keep marinate wave equal to 1, where the anomaly layer is higher to 1.5 Kelvin. Click on test. Okay, and then you can click on OK. If we deactivate this layer, we can see that we have only polygons remaining on zones where the anomaly, the weakly anomaly layer, is higher than 1.5 Kelvin. So finally, you can export this filter vector polygon layer to a shapefile format. So vector polygons here, right click on it, go to export, save feature as, and here change the format to S3 shapefile. We are then going to change the output name and call this vector polygon layer filtered with marinate wave areas point shapefile. Just browse to the good directory. And you don't need to add the extension because it's automatically added. Then you can click on save. Okay, we have the output name here. The field is marinate wave, and then you can click on OK. So this new shapefile layer has been added on top of our layer panel. Once we have the polygons and areas of marinate wave located here, we are going now to map the coral reef areas and then try to intersect the areas of marinate wave occurring and areas of coral reef to identify the endangered and threatened coral reef. So to compute this intersection, we have highlighted the marinate wave areas. Here you can see them. And we are now going to map the coral reef and then compute the intersection. To load the coral reef file, you can just go to layer, add layer, and we are going to add a shapefile, so a vector layer. Here you can browse to your directories and going to find your reef shapefile. This shapefile is a file containing the coral reef distribution all around the world, distributed by UNEP WCMC World Fish Center. Here it is, the reef underscore 500 poly shapefile. Click on open and click on add. Then you can close. You can see that the coral reef polygons are represented as areas like this. And now, in this original shapefile, the different coral reefs are only grouped in a single entity. If we select the eye and the arrow icon here, and you click on one polygon of coral, you can see that we have selected all the polygons. What we want to do is to just split all these coral reef in single entities in order to identify only entities that are touching or intersecting a marine heat wave areas. To do so, we need again to open the processing toolbox. So click on processing and toolbox here. And you can just type the function multiparts to multiparts to single parts. So you can just type vector geometry, and here we are going to select this function multipart to single part. Just double click on it to open it, and we are going to split from a single entity to individual polygons using this option. To do so, we need to select the Riff 500 polygon here and then click on run. So on the, you can close this function. On this layer, single parts, you have all the same polygons as the Riff 500 poly layer, but all individually splitted. Here, if again you select the identify feature tool and you click on only one polygon, you can see that we have splitted all individual entities. Once it is done, each entity of Coral Reef is accessible individually, as I just showed you. And we are now going to compute the intersection between marine heat wave areas, squared in orange, with single entities polygons here. To do so, we are going to filter this single parts layer corresponding to coral reef individual entities, and we are going to only select those which touches, intersect or cross marine heat waves areas polygon. To do so, you can click on vector, and on research tool we are going to select by location. Here we want to select features from the single part layer, and we are going to select features that intersect, touch or cross marine heat wave areas polygons. And we want to compare the features from marine heat wave areas, this layer in orange. Now you can just click on run, and it's going to compute the intersection of the two layers. So it may take some time. For each polygon of the single part layer, it's checking if there is one pixel in orange, one marine heat wave pixel converted to polygon that touches, intersect or crosses this single part polygon. So when the task is completed, just close this window, and you don't have a new layer here, but all the polygons which are in contact with marine heat wave areas are just highlighted in yellow. If we close the processing tool and the identify result, you can see here that all the coral reef touching marine heat wave areas are in yellow. So in the last step of this training, we are going to export these selected entities, so this coral reef that are threatened and at risk, from the single part layer. So right click on the single part layer, go to export, and here we are going not to select save feature as, but save selected feature as, in order to select only feature in yellow, sorry. Click on it, and here you can choose between S3 shapefile format or GeoJSON format. Here we are going to select S3 shapefile format. Select the file name. And here we are going to call this resulting layer to coral reef at risk and the marine heat wave also. Here you can click on save and then click OK. So if you deactivate all the layers of polygons of coral reefs, you can see that only coral reef at risk, in contact, intersection, and crossing of marine heat wave pixels are selected. So now, this coral reef at risk marine heat wave layer contains the reefs the most at risk, which need to be checked in priority in case of marine heat wave episode. So in this training, we use the NetCDF to GIS plugin to manipulate and visualize Copernicus Marine Service daily SST observation products for different years. It enabled us to compute and analyze an SST anomaly and characterize a marine heat wave event. And then we used a database containing world coral reef location and extents from the global distribution of warm water coral reef to determine which coral were at risk in contact with marine heat wave episode. This coral data are from the UNEP distribution, and you can find them following the link described in in the user manual training. Now it's your turn. This scenario is workable with other dates and other areas of interest. Just go to the Copernicus Marine Service and download other Copernicus Marine Service data to check which coral reefs are threatened by current marine heat wave. We also saw in this training how to tune layer representation. So just let's go and try yourself. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.